Hi everybody, my name is Hannah and this is Pepper and Pine, and today I want to share with you a project and also how to make your own patterns. So I am talking with my daughter as I'm doing this, so I've got a lot going on here, but I'm going to try to walk you through this. I have three skeins of embroidery floss and I wasn't quite sure which one I want to use, and I love all three of them, but I'm going to share that with you a little bit later. Right now I want to show you how I'm going to make this pattern. I've got this beautiful coral colored felt. It's 100% wool felt, and that's going to be important for this project especially. Now, and I have my wool filling also off to the side, and I had a little bit of silk there for this project because it is for a seahorse, and I was trying to figure out how to make some of those flappy appendages on the seahorse, and I thought that the silk would do the job, but it doesn't, and so it doesn't even get used for this project. This is me trying to freehand a seahorse, and for such a simple silhouette, I'm actually having kind of a hard time with it. Now, that's my first tip. To do this kind of pattern making, I would recommend going with something that's a pretty obvious silhouette. So, like a tree or a dog, or in this case, a seahorse. This is going to end up being pretty flat in the end. It's still three-dimensional, but not quite as much as some intermediate projects. So I am just going to be freehanding the seahorse. Now I am struggling here and I keep erasing this part. And in a minute, I am just going to turn off my camera, which is my phone, and then go and Google a couple of images so that I can kind of see what I am trying to make here. When I do this, I realize that there are quite a few ridges along the backside of the seahorse, so I add those in as well. At this point, I am just going to give my pattern a rough cut because I'd rather just spend the time cutting once, which would include the pattern and the two pieces of felt, rather than doing all those intricate cuts on my pattern and then doing it again for each piece of felt. This has its challenges as well. So I'm trying to kind of do a very specific cut around my pattern, but then I realize with all that extra felt, I am just going to sort of give it a rough cut and then start doing the details afterwards. So I'm gonna kind of do the nose part. I don't even know if that's the correct terminology for the seahorse, but that long piece, I kind of do it fairly accurately, but I end up with a little bit of a problem, and that's because the felt kind of shifts as you are cutting it, so it ends up being kind of a little bit too narrow, but that's okay. In the end, it turns out just fine. So here's kind of a little trick on how to get those really nice ridges or kind of any kind of detailed cut when you're working with felt. I've got my pattern and two layers of felt, and I am just cutting while twisting the felt in my left hand. So my right hand is squeezing the scissors and I'm kind of just turning the felt. And I know that probably seems obvious, but had I done my pattern first, I probably would have gone in there with some tiny scissors and I would not have gotten it looking that well. It would have been more like peaks and valleys rather than these nice kind of curved little hills or mountains. Anyway, so let's move on. I am going to now pick out the embroidery floss that I'm going to use to stitch this whole project together. And I decide on the lighter color one, and you can find the names of all of those colors down in the description box below. So I want to quickly show you how I store my embroidery floss. I do have a complete tutorial on how I did this, but as I got new embroidery floss, you know, I need to actually put them in with my old ones. And so I take it off of the skein and I am now wrapping it over on itself about 4 times. Now the rest of the ones that I already have done, I did it about 8 times. So they're smaller lengths, and that works well for a lot of projects, but for some projects I need a longer length. So it kind of depends on the projects that you do, and then you can decide how long you want to cut your embroidery floss. This keeps it so neat and so tidy. It is so much easier than just having them loose, and it's just one way to organize your embroidery floss. And it's super easy to take out just one length. Now I want to separate the strands. For some high quality embroidery flosses, you'll notice that it comes with 6 different strands kind of woven together. I just separated them out so I had 3 strands each, and so just one length is going to work for the entire project. One length as in this one as well as one more. So once you separate them, you end up with quite a bit more. So I'm going to start at this point in the project and, or, you know, within the pattern, and I am hiding my knot inside the two layers. You didn't see that very well, but I basically started my stitching within one layer of felt, and now I can go ahead and do a loop stitch on both of them. So I thought that the loop stitch would be the easiest for this. I didn't want any extra details around the edges of my pattern. I wanted to keep it pretty simple, but I also wanted to keep it pretty tight since I want to stuff this with some stuffing. So for the loop stitch or any stitch that you're going to do that's very close to the edge of felt, you want to make sure that your wool content is pretty high. If you use polyacrylic felt from the craft store, you're not going to be able to get a good stitch around it. It's probably going to tear. And also the nose part appendage of the seahorse, something that small probably wouldn't hold up well with acrylic felt as well. So this is 100% wool felt. I know that you can find wool blends as well. I'm going to leave a few different links down the description box below of some other vendors where you can find really nice felt that is wool blend. So it will work well for a project like this, and it's a little bit more affordable. I am a diehard fan of the 100% wool felt, and so I am going to be using that. Now, I used a little pencil just to kind of stuff that little end piece. You want to stuff as you go, especially when you're doing the tail, because if you stitch more than 5 or 6 stitches, you are not going to be able to stuff it in well, and then it's going to be really hard and clumpy in some areas and then empty in other areas. So you want to kind of be mindful of when you're doing that. I did about 4 or 5 stitches, and then I stuffed a little bit more, and then I continued doing that. Kind of used my needle to kind of keep it down below my stitch line because I didn't want any of the stuffing kind of coming out. And you can see that my stitches are very close together. So once I was done with the tail, I moved on to the rest of the body. And at this point, I want to continue stuffing because otherwise I'm going to end up without any opening to get down into the rest of the body. For this project, I am kind of keeping it lightly stuffed. I didn't want it too hard. It's still really mushy. And you can see at this point that the pattern really just kind of showcases the silhouette aspect of this. It's not really a three-dimensional project in a way. I know the terminology is not really great here that I'm trying to explain. The difference in kind of making, say, for instance, a tree that could stand up and would have like a round trunk and a full foliage around the branches, or you could do something that's a bit more two-dimensional and get the silhouette of a tree. So these projects that I'm doing right now, since they are beginning stitching projects and beginning pattern making projects, you're just going to do something that's more of a silhouette, which I think is a lot easier for both a new, if you're new at doing patterns and new at stitching, and especially for a child, because this project goes about pretty quickly. My 11-year-old son did this in no time at all, and the project was very satisfying. Once he was done, he was very happy with his project, and so that's something to keep in mind when you're doing a stitching project like this, is that if you keep it simple, you can get it done faster, and you can be just as pleased with it. If you want intermediate projects, I am also leaving some links in the description box below to some kits that have intermediate stitching projects that include the pattern as well. The last thing I want to do for this project is add some eyes to the seahorse, and I'm just going back and forth with some black embroidery floss, and that's it. And it turned out super cute. It is better than I expected. Those little ridges in the back really give it some good detail. If you wanted to get a little bit more creative, you could even stitch some embroidery lines across the whole body of the seahorse to make it look a little bit more authentic. But I think that it is really obvious what it is, and I am super pleased with the way it turned out. For more information, don't forget to check the description box below. And if you want to check out some of the other projects that we're up to, I've left a couple of videos on the screen for you. And don't forget that if you want to see what we're up to on a daily basis, you can find me on Instagram at Pepper and Pine.